year and the next day gone. Sometimes you win, sometimes you stay, sometimes you turn your back to the wind. There's a world outside at the dark in your door. The winds won't want you even more. You're brave, I'm free, and you love her so. Come back to me to the distance. She is tame to break down. Tell me it's about it.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Yeah, Michelle, don't act like you're surprised. What do you think? What is this, the first time I've picked music? Come on now. I mean, what else are you gonna play? She's all hooked up. Okay. Make sure that we got everybody muted. How is everyone this morning? Amber says she's hot. You just got done working out?
I just finished the last workout and I totally didn't cry. Not even a little bit.
I'll turn that down a little bit. Well, we are just waiting. So we'll let it play for a minute. It's an absolutely gorgeous day here in Carmel. We've already been up. We've been for our walk. We've been to the farmer's market. Dude, let's get it all. Let's get it all going. All right, we'll just hang out and wait a couple minutes. Oh, there she is. Carey, you just popped on. She's connected to audio. Let me see her. Yeah, you're muted. Hang on. I'm going to make you the other host, though. There we go. So you... There, now you're unmuted. Okay, hold on. Let me turn my music down.
I like your music, though. See what you did there.
One of the girls was like, oh, great song. I'm like, do you think this is the first time that I've had a speaker? I mean, come on now.
That's awesome.
We know what's happening here. This is so exciting for us. I am just so you know, Carey, like I am kind of geeking out about this because I'm just so excited to have you on our book talk this morning. And what probably my team doesn't really know is you and I have never met in person, and somehow we've got to be friends on Instagram. I heard an interview by you, I think maybe on Entree Leadership or Success Magazine, bought the book, fell in love with the book, started following you on Instagram. By following, I mean started stalking you on Instagram, you know, created a friendship on Instagram, and we have never met in person. And for the past several months, I've been like, when's your next book? When's your next book? When's your next book? So the next book is coming out in fall, and that's very exciting. It just looks really amazing. So I've just been a fan for a long time. I think your first book's amazing. Your life story is incredible, and there's just nothing more powerful to start a Saturday morning than with super badass female author, speaker, life story, you know, to share with us. And so I'm just going to invite you to share kind of a little bit your story and talk, and we'll do Q&A and talk about your book, and the whole shebang, and the chat is open, and they can ask questions and all those things. Does that work for you?
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm here for you.
Yay. So exciting.
Yeah, that was a great intro. And good morning, everybody. And Julie, I think you do such an amazing job on Instagram. For those of you who don't know, if you let me make sure my ringer's off here. I'm off and on Instagram. I'm a bit more of a lurker. I, up until about the last 3 months ago, I travel nonstop. So I do about 100 keynotes a year. So I do more on Instagram stories because it disappears. But probably like a lot of you right now, I own my own business. I do a lot of executive coaching. I do a lot of keynotes, but I also have 4 kids. So up until a week ago, my daily habit and routine and everything has been completely flipped upside down. And I've got 3 out of 4 vying for bandwidth and attention and trying to get school done. And I'm still on the phone. And so I've pulled back big time, even for me, on social media. I appreciate, Julie, that you continue to show up because, you know, I'll still say, I'm like, oh, there she is, 4:45, showered and sparkly. I'm like, maybe I need a haircut. Maybe that'll help me out. I don't know. But I'm like, so I thank you for continuing to show up because, you know, I think one of the lessons, and I'll get kind of back into my story, but for all of us right now, everybody in here, whether you're new to this, you're just starting to grow your business, you've been in it for a while, or maybe you're stagnating. You know, I think sometimes now that we're kind of, now that we've been in a longer period of uncertainty, that if you've kind of been settling back and waiting for normal to come back, it's clear that we're not going back to a new normal, right? And I don't even think we are where we're going to be 30 days from now. So I think right now, and it's great to kick off a Saturday, and I can see everybody's still, a lot of people are in their workout gear, as am I, hair's up, that we just take a second to refocus and remember what our mission is, right? And that who are we here to serve, and that we're here to help other people, not only ourselves while we're on this journey to really achieve their goals and to live a healthy and fulfilling life. And that if we, in my world, and Julie kind of hinted a little bit, I was a fighter pilot, one of the very first women to be assigned to fly the F-14 Tomcat in the United States Navy. And so operating in this really complex and dynamic environment, one of these skill sets that we had to be able to learn and to pick up on is to constantly be working to clarify the complex. And as you can imagine, so I'll just take you through for just a few minutes kind of my journey, if that's okay with you guys. I know you've had lots of different cool speakers, and everybody comes to this from a different table, and you've got, you know, people like, we're just Trent Shelton like, and just douche punching you in the face with like nuggets of wisdom and awesome. And I'm from the Midwest. I'm a little more chill. Hopefully equally as inspiring, but maybe just a little more chill. But just to give you some context, I do want to walk you through my story just a little bit so that it'll help you understand how I come to where I am today with sharing principles of leadership and high performance, and hopefully still doing a, you know, pretty baller job at raising good kids and a business at the same time, right? And not losing my mind in the process. So. If we take it back for just a second, if we think about how do we lead through this time, right? And obviously you've got a great system, you've got a great support network, a great set of tools right now. And Julie, you do a great job as a leader. But when we turn that spotlight inwards, though, oftentimes when we get really overwhelmed, it gets back to the genesis or the baseline of how do you lead yourself first? How do you go beyond the impossible or what feels like it can be impossible? How do you push yourself? How do you push others when you might have people right now, even within your circle, saying, you know, kind of who do you think you are? What do you, how are you going to be successful during this time? You know, everybody's really strapped, or nobody wants to hear about this little fitness challenge, or, you know, stop with this already. It's not, you know, it's not that important. I have other things to worry about. And sometimes that, you know, the goals that we're given either, you know, by the outside big piece or by our team leaders or even by ourselves, things that we may have written down, it may feel impossible. And what I want you to know right now on this Saturday morning, June, wherever we are, June 20th, is you are not alone. You are not alone, right? The feeling that things can be impossible right now, it's very real, and it can be very overwhelming. But what I would encourage you to consider is that right now, double down, because right now there is a call for each and every one of us to lead more fearlessly. And what I want to share with you today are a couple of these principles and tools that we used as naval aviators that you can apply to your own leadership, your own self-leading journey, your entrepreneur journey, your parenting journey, if you've got kids. And I want you to think about, how do you take your vision of where you want to go and flip it into action? How do you build your ability to work through fear so you can get what needs to be done, not only for you yourself, but for others, in spite of that fear, and have that courage to figure it out? And the good news is, you don't have to predict that future right now, right? You just have to make sure that you are stepping up and that you're putting yourself in a successful position to build that future. So let me take a second to introduce you into my office, into the cockpit of a $45 million fighter jet. Now, oftentimes people think that this is something that is not just mentally challenging, but it's physically challenging as well. Because what most people don't realize is that as Navy fighter pilots, specifically different than the other forces, we are put in a leadership position where as soon as we show up into a squadron, we're in charge of 250 to 300 people with assets valued at right around $1 billion. So somehow I have to figure out if I might start off as an educational services officer where I have to suddenly implement training programs and make sure 300 people are certified and headed in the right direction. And I have no idea, I've never done this before, and I finally get my feet underneath me, and 3 to 4 months later, I switch roles. Now I might be an assistant maintenance officer, or I might be an assistant admin officer, jobs I've never done before. But each 3 to 4 months, we're switching roles. And what happens in this is that you developed this rhythm, this execution rhythm, that you are okay with uncertainty, and you're able to move in and out of positions where you get deep into the tactics of getting the stuff done and keeping up and keeping yourself at a 35,000 foot level to go, okay, where are we going? What's the vision? What's our purpose? And then getting back down into tactics. And what it also allows you to do as you're switching lanes within this business is that it helps you uncover blind spots, because you don't stay siloed in what you do. So you don't think like what you're doing right now, like every day I need to show up on Instagram, I just need to get this one piece done. And as long as I get this one piece done, everything's gonna be okay. It's writing down a plan, right? Because we want a plan to succeed, and then executing on that, but moving back and forth. So regardless of whether I'm an educational services officer or I'm a maintenance officer, every day we have goals, and we set that plan of the day. We set those goals, we write them down, and so it shows a level of commitment, and then everybody can execute on it. Now, everybody has different, I'm gonna kind of go in and out of this a little bit, because I think what's really relevant for this is that regardless of the format with which you do this in, some of you might have push journals, right? Shalene Johnson push journals. Somebody, you might have a focus journal from Michael Hyatt, or you might be, I'm looking around because my desk is kind of a mess right now, but I'm sorry, I know this is kind of crunchy. I'm a huge legal pad person.
right? And a black fat Sharpie marker. Say that three times fast. Because for whatever reason, for me, when I write stuff down in black fat Sharpie marker, I can remember it a lot better. But the key for me in the clarity of goals, and whether it is working with my team, doing executive coaching, or a team of 200 people that I'm working through a strategic plan, it's always about understanding and making sure everybody knows the clarity and our sense of purpose. Because when you can write down your sense of your purpose and that clarity is the number one thing that will determine whether or not you are successful. Having clarity on that goal, because when people understand what their purpose is, everything else should support that. Knowing your purpose, if you are not clear on your purpose, your chances of success, regardless of how high-end and sophisticated your tools are, your chances of success go down completely, or go down tremendously. So we want to think about, you know, what does success look like? What is our purpose? On the aircraft carrier, that clarity of vision and purpose, we all knew what success looked like. It was with 5,000 people on board a ship, it boiled down to simply supporting the safe launching and recovering of airplanes. That's it. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Everything else is just tactics. So whether you worked in food service, you worked in intelligence, you worked in facilities, everything we did in these different areas had to tie to and thread back to supporting the safe launching and recovering of airplanes. Because no different than you, this sophisticated team of 5,000 is getting pulled in way too many different directions, is being overtasked, is under-resourced, and we simply don't have enough time to get done all the things that everybody's telling us we need to get done. So what that purpose does, and constantly working to clarify that complex, it lets us say no to those things that don't support us getting that job done. So when we think of this, when you think about your businesses that you're running right now, if you can't put your purpose with your fat Sharpie marker on a post-it note in a sentence, you are going to struggle. You will struggle. It's too complicated, and you won't be able to do the most important work. Because if you don't have that purpose, you do not know exactly what business you are in, what you are trying to accomplish, and the values that drive the behavior and the decision-making day in and day out will change. And then you will never be as successful as you want to be. Because if you don't know that purpose, the further you get away from the muddy sort of kind of idea of what you think you want to do, you won't operate with integrity, because everything is not serving and supporting and marshaling those resources of what it is that you're trying to get done. Does that make sense? So there's no question in my mind that for each and every one of us, bold, fearless leadership starts with having that vision. A clear vision will inspire you and your team to align your actions and your choices to what it is that you are trying to get done. And what we have to remember is, again, regardless of the tools that you have at your disposal, regardless of how long you've been in this industry, you are the catalyst to moving your performance and your team's performance. You are. And you are the catalyst to seeing the possibilities in what is, the reality of what is right now, and also what can be. And in order to get these results, we have to be able to establish these goals and then start aligning our actions so that we get to where we want to go faster. In my world, speed was life, right? The faster we could move, the faster we would get things done. If we're turning in and things are looking great, that's awesome. If they're bad, we need to make a decision and run away really quickly. If we are struggling then we want to be able to pull over to the side and ask for help. But we need to be able to move very, very quickly so that we can adapt and remain agile in this constantly changing marketplace. And it's getting clarity on what you want to accomplish and how you are showing up so that you're helping other people get to a more valuable place in their lives as well. So when we net all this down, again, I try to keep things in three things. So I want you to think about being the catalyst as three things that matter: purpose, focus, and discipline. And again, why purpose? Because purpose is the single most important factor in your success and the people that you're supporting their success. Who are you here for? Purpose is your anchor. If you think about it as a boat, right? If you don't drop that anchor, you are all over the lake, right? You got no shot. You're still a boat and you might be a super pretty boat, but you're all over the place and you're not bringing anybody with you. So be clear on what you want to accomplish and what you want your team to accomplish. And that simplicity always will beat complexity every single time. And then work with purpose. Just focus on what matters. When you establish that vision and you align your actions towards that common end state and drive out everything that doesn't support it, and you wrap all that up with enthusiasm, man, that is like the afterburner for your team, right? And I'm not talking, we all know, we probably can think about somebody when I talk about enthusiasm, that person who's always showing up and every single day, they're so excited, right? They're like, oh my gosh, I'm so happy to be here. Hashtag blessed. Oh, you are so awesome. I love you all, right? And you're like, stop it. My dog just threw up in the kitchen and my kid just had a blowout all the way up to their hair, right? I'm not in the mood for this today. Can't do it. But so when I say show up with enthusiasm, what I want you to think about is that you are part of an ecosystem right now that is a culture of excellence, right? It's a culture of standards, and that how you show up matters. And that when you show up with a great attitude is like the afterburner for your team. But here is the key. What a great attitude and one of positivity does is that it does, although it doesn't guarantee your success, a negative attitude kills your ability to adapt. And that is key, because we all know on this journey, we're going to be in and out of the ditch on occasion. We're going to have a couple of setbacks. We're going to have some successes. We're going to have some darker periods. But if you stay in a negative place, it kills your ability to adapt and recover. And if we're looking to help other people as well as ourselves go further on this journey, we just have to show up with a great attitude. And we can do that. It's a little bit easier to do that when we know what it is we're trying to accomplish, because again, purpose is our filter. We want to keep it simple. We want to stay clear on what we want to achieve and what we want our team to achieve. When you think about, sorry, I've got like a stray hair on my nose. When you think about I operate in this three-dimensional battlefield in space, right? A lot of noise, a lot of chaos. I'm in this cockpit, 350 switches and dials, three different radios with people talking in my ear all at the same time, oftentimes feeding me conflicting information. So I have to be able to very quickly sort through that information while clearly we are trying not to hit each other, right? Or the ground or anything attached to the ground. And so we have to be able to make sure that we are staying focused on what matters, because if you lose sight of what matters, you will lose the fight, guaranteed. Again, I don't care how well supported you are. If you let yourself get pulled in a million different directions, you are guaranteed to lose the fight. And what happens, and what some of you may be experiencing right now, is that when we start to get overwhelmed, we start experiencing a fear of failure, right? And the fear of failure is one of the most universally paralyzing things that we all suffer from, fighter pilots included. And what happens is that when you are afraid to fail, you end up passing up very valuable opportunities. simply because you're afraid to fail. And unfortunately, the overwhelming majority of us underestimate our ability to recover from failure. And so what happens is that when you're pushed, when you're being pushed and you're told, I think you can do this. I think you can hit a bigger number. I think you can do more. That doubt and that distraction and that inaction, that because we're paralyzed, starts to settle in and we go, nope, I'm going to wait just a little bit longer. I'm gonna wait to show more of my workouts until I'm a little bit fitter. I'm gonna wait to make the ask until I feel a little more competent. I'm gonna read another book until I'm a little bit smarter because, you know, my cousin Bessie said, "Who do you think you are? I ran around with you in seventh grade. Who do you think you are to tell me I can do this or that you should be a successful business person? I've seen your kind," right? And we become paralyzed and we wait. And what happens is that while we're waiting, somebody else who has just a little bit more courage or confidence or trust in themselves that they'll figure it out steps in and they do it. And it's the only way. So while you are afraid to fail, while you think you are playing it safe and you are risk managing by reading more books, by trying to get all the things just right because you want to roll it out perfect and you want to show up perfect and you don't want to make any mistakes, you have now actually put yourself more at risk. So don't be afraid on this journey to fail. Do not be afraid of that. It's just how quickly you can learn from it and what you do with it that ultimately will determine not only who you are as a person, but what you are able to achieve individually, and as importantly, who you are able to serve and bring with you. Do not be afraid to fail. It's just what you do with it and how quickly you can learn from it that actually will ultimately determine how successful you are. So, you know, we had to operate in an environment where the threat of failure was very real and it was very visible. And one of the scariest things that you can do, and I'll kind of share this piece and then I'll go back and we can go back and forth and chat about this. One of the scariest things you can do in all of aviation is land on an aircraft carrier at night. And Navy and Marine Corps fighter pilots are the only fighter pilots in the world who actually land high-speed fighters on aircraft carriers at night because it's that dangerous. Nobody else will do it. And so when obviously there's a lot of pressure, and if you're interested at all in how things can go wrong, there are a lot of ways you can search that out on YouTube and just Google or look up a ramp strike. It usually ends in a fireball and it doesn't go very well. So there's a lot of pressure, and that yet all you can do, even though every time you show up and it's inky black outside and somebody may have just crashed and you're still getting launched into that darkness where you can't even see your hand in front of your face, the only way you get a little bit better at that is to continue to show up again and again and again. And it doesn't mean that you're ever going to get rid of that hair standing on the back of your neck or completely covered in sweat or kind of clean up on aisle five messy, but it gives you a little more courage to continue to show up and trust that you'll be able to figure it out. So it's knowing that you've got just enough, you've done the preparation, you've done the planning, and yet you still have to take action to get the job done. So I kind of want to open it up there. There are a couple of other things that I want to share with you about kind of about preparation and planning on how we handle things that I think you would probably be successful for you. But Julie, what questions do you have? What does your team have?
Well, first of all, I've already taken like six pages of notes. And my first thought was listening to you talk about trying to land an aircraft on a ship in the dark, and someone's going to be afraid to send an invite to a challenge group. Like, really, let's have some perspective here. You know, that was my first thought. Like, I'm listening to you talk about that thinking, who, I'm standing here in my workout clothes. Who thinks this job's hard? You know, when you're talking about landing an airplane on an aircraft, it's just, there's so much perspective in what you're sharing. And the skill set, though, that transfers over into no matter what the job is, you know, how purpose being your anchor. And I wrote that down somewhere, that the skill, the writing down the plan, the executing on the plan, and having them each day is a skill that transfers to all jobs, no matter what you are doing. So if you, maybe you could speak to that a little bit. We have in the Beachbody world, we have a tracker that mm-hmm. kind of guides people to here are your activities that you should be doing every day. But what I think you're also saying is that's okay. Yeah, we know all that, but what are your activities or what is your goal for this particular day? Or is that what you're writing down when you're making your plan, your goal for the day, what are you writing down?
Yes. Yes. And the challenge with, I would submit to you, with even with your tracker is that, and I am so sorry, y'all. I literally, have you ever had like that stray hair that somehow you're like, I swear to goodness, I have it. And yet it's, I can still see it somewhere. Yet it's just tickling me enough. This is why I could never be a politician, because I'd be talking about something. I'd be like, Oh, nobody told me about that. Thanks. I digress. So here's where it's the, what people fail to do and what is oftentimes with the teams that I work with and the executives that I coach, accountability is a four-letter word, because you have this fabulous tracker, and that only when we take the time and hold the mirror up and go, I'm going to pretend like nobody's watching me. And I'm going to go over and I'm going to look at this just for a second. Have I actually done everything in there that it's telling me to do? Because I promise you, when you are afraid, you are skipping some of those steps because you're afraid of pushback. You're afraid somebody is going to tell you, you know, you get that imposter feeling, or you think, I know I should do that, but I do not want to show up on social media every day. Like, have you seen my, like, I'm tired, right? Nobody needs to see this, right? And we think we can skip the steps, but what happens is that you have to continue to show up, because in this market space particularly, and Julie, obviously I've followed you for quite some time on social media. There's another Beachbody, well, there are a couple of other Beachbody gals that I follow as well. And it's fascinating because even from one of them, it was probably only after like 9 months where I was finally like, wait a minute, what exactly does she, what does she do? Like, you all assume because you're in it that people understand what it is you do. And I sent her a note and was like, you might not realize this, but I actually can't figure out what you do. Like, what am I supposed to be joining you in? And she was like, I had no idea. So we all have to look within, follow your plan is only as good as yes, your plan, but also in the execution of it and the clarity of your message. So for me, even now, what I do, yes, I have an overall plan, and obviously things have changed for me in the last 3 months because I'm not traveling nearly as much. But so a lot of it has been, I've been on the phone nonstop, and I've been doing just tons of coaching and strategic planning, and I have been doing online, virtual stuff. But I have an overall plan and an overall set of goals and things I need to be, get done. And I have a new book coming out, but then what I do, and I'm trying to think, I think it just kind of fell off. What I do is I take on my sticky notes every day. I'm a big post-it note girl. And I take every single morning, and sometimes I'll do it the night before, but usually every morning before I start opening up my inbox, and I write down the three most important things that I have to do. The three most important things. And in the last 3 months for me, the general umbrella has been family, fitness, and finances. And for me, it's the finances is the business piece. but I always do three things. Now, will you have 17 things some days? Yes, but I promise you, you do not have 17 things that if you move the lever on that, they will have as an equal impact than if you do the three most important things. Nobody has 17 things that are equally as important. And I'm not talking the table stakes things about getting your kids fed or, you know, making sure you don't lose track of your dog or whatever that is. Like that's life, right? And those are real challenges. But it's what are your three most important things that you could do today to drive your business forward? And sometimes those three most important things and why you hesitate to do them is because it does expose you to pushback. It does expose your vulnerabilities, or one of them may open up a Pandora's box of, oh, if I do this, now I have to do these six other things. Well, start with that. Don't start with organizing your shelves. Don't start with folding your laundry. Don't start with doing all the other things that feel sort of productive, but are doing absolutely nothing to drive your business. Because it's in all of that distraction that we lose momentum. And it's when you get little wins along the way of momentum that get you back into helping your mission of helping people live a more valuable life. Does that make sense?
Yes, that's, and I wrote in the chat so that I wouldn't forget, when you are writing those three pieces, are those three actions that you want to take this day, or are those three overriding goals that you have for your month, your year, whatever? Are those like, these are three actions. I'm recording a podcast, I'm filming a video, I'm blah, blah, blah.
Okay, so that's a great question. So what I want you to think about is, so for me, and in my handy dandy guide here, I break how we do all this into a couple of different sections. Individually, you know, there are the individual principles of courage, tenacity, and integrity, right? Those are three core values, the courage, tenacity, and integrity. Fearless leadership in action, though, whether you're running a Fortune 1 company or you are just starting out right now in the Beachbody ecosphere, if you will, we need to look at, you know, first of all, again, what is that vision? So Julie, I'm gonna get to your question. You know, what we have to do again is we have to be really clear on that vision so we can stay inspired and we can inspire the people that we are trying to bring with us. So we need to understand with clarity what success looks like. Now, Julie, for you, if you were to sit down this morning, you know, after we get done and you're halfway through your second jug of Energize and you're like, okay, this is what success looks like for me from July, August, and September, your sticky note of what success looks like is going to probably be different than your newest member on your team. That's okay. And or maybe somebody who's just had their third baby and they're like, you know what, success looks like me getting an hour and 12 minutes of sleep in one night at the same time uninterrupted. So we need to be really clear on what success looks like from that vision perspective so that we can really focus. And then when we're thinking about our plan, again, three things. I call it prepare, perform, and prevail. So in the preparation phase is where we do our planning. This can take 5 minutes, it can take 10 minutes, it can take 2 hours. It depends on how detailed and how granular you want to go. But the reason we always invest in planning, and it doesn't matter if I'm on day 27 flying the 27th same flight in a row, we always take time to plan. Right? We write our plan down. We put it on the big whiteboard. We brief our team. Maybe you're a team of one. So you're like, okay, self, today, this is what we're going to do, right? And we go through what it's going to look like. And then we go, so that's the preparation phase. And the reason we always do this planning and preparation phase is so that we understand and we're really clear on what that mission objective is. So we get that planning, because what we actually want to get to the point is our execution rhythm, our day to day, has almost become a habit. Because we want the execution to be boring. I don't want to wake up every day to firefighting in my inbox. I want to develop a routine, an execution rhythm that allows me to then do the really valuable work, the reflective work, the figuring out how I can better serve my audience, my people, my teammates. So that tracker becomes such an execution rhythm that I get to the point where if I'm not going through that every day, now the hair on the back of my neck is standing up, because I know I'm missing something. I'm missing a critical piece or a critical component that will allow me to achieve, or somebody I'm bringing with me on this fitness and health journey, success. And then at the end of every flight, we debrief, because we want to figure out very quickly what's working, what's not, and why. And we're doing this to not only discover what's not working, but if we had a success, if all of a sudden, you know, for 2 weeks we were showing up on Instagram, and all of a sudden I look I fire up my Instagram, and I'm just using that as a platform because I think that tends to be where a lot of you are residing right now. And share with me if it's not, like in the chat box, say, no, I'm actually working LinkedIn hard, or I'm working Facebook hard. If all of a sudden I have 15 new followers and I'm like, ooh, I did something positive. So you want to capture what that is. You don't want to go, oh, I'm awesome. Like that hit it right there. Like, I didn't know people wanted to see my 45 bras, or I didn't know they wanted to see my dog, or whatever it may be. And you write that down, because of the goal is to not leave success to chance. And if you're only celebrating the wins and not capturing them, or you let your mind keep dropping anchor on the negatives, you're never going to be able to move past that. So when we think of the prepare, perform, prevail phase, the planning part is, we always write down, what is our mission objective, right? What are we trying to do? What does success look like? And then here are my action items. Right? So on my post-it note of my three very, you know, most important things for the day, it might be two interviews, right? Two interviews that I need to do, 1,000 words, and, coaching plan for so-and-so, right? So I don't write coaching plan and my 17 steps that I need to write on that, because I know in these three things already what needs to be accomplished within them. So when I say the three most important things, I'm not going detailed into my course of action for each of those. It's the three big things. So say if you need to send out those invitations, it might be, you know, launch my invitations, and then over here on your legal pad or within your tracker system or whatever, you're like step by step. Those are the tactics, right? So that's kind of the difference between your strategy, your three big things, and your tactics. The tactics are the doing of them. Does that make sense? Okay. But when part of why we write this stuff down too is that kinesthetically, and all the research shows that when you are actually not just reading, but you're writing down your plan or the pieces of your plan, your brain has now already gone a step further into the commitment piece of it. And your chances of actually following through on it are much greater than if you just tell yourself, yeah, I know I have to do that today. That's why even me at this point, I mean, that's why I use stickies. And what I do and what I tell my folks that I coach for the first 30 days of any coaching thing, engagement, I'll tell them, I want you to start off by doing one big thing. I want you at the beginning of every day, before you open up any device, laptop, start scrolling your Instagram real quick, or Twitter, or whatever the case may be, run into your office, your nightstand, your bathroom, whatever you do, write down your three most important things. And if I'm at home, I put it up on my laptop. If I'm on the road, my pop socket's in a different place, but I put it on my phone, because I almost always have my phone with me, right? So when my phone's flipped over, it's a constant reminder of these are the three most important things that I can do to drive my business today. And eventually what happens is that when you that becomes a habit for you, you start saying no to all those things that don't support you doing your most valuable work. And that, quite frankly, is the difference between people who become high performers and those who don't. It's having that ability to focus and focus on what matters most. Because when you allow yourself to get super distracted and pulled in every which direction, that's the biggest challenge. So one thing, and I know where I don't want to monopolize all this time, but one of the things that I want to share with you that that is going to be a part of my new book, and it's just a piece, but it's an idea that I've talked about lots before, either in other workshops, but this idea of task overload and multitasking, because I'm sure everybody on here, the women for sure, have heard, oh, women are better multitaskers than men, right? Scientifically, actually, that's not the case. I know, which is super disappointing for all of us. And I have a husband, I've been married for 26 years, and I'm telling you, I actually do think we're better multitaskers. I don't care what the science says. That being said, task overload is the number one killer to good execution for all of us. It is the real challenge for all of us when we are trying to be successful to actually try to get our jobs done. And your real superpower is determining those items that are firmly within your span of control, which is what my new book title is, but those things that are within your span of control and those that are not. Because chaos right now is killing a lot of us. It's leaving our teams, our friends, and our families frazzled, overwhelmed. We're stressed out. We're drowning in uncertainty. And for the majority of us, particularly, I'm going to say geographically Americans, what we have tended to do in the last 3 to 5 years, a new element, a new layer has been put upon us from a numbing perspective, Netflix and social media, right? And Netflix, Hulu, whatever you want to call it. And that combined with food. And when you combine those two things, it's killing us. And the task overload piece is, it's huge. And when we fall into this trap of thinking that we can multitask and that task overload is not going to happen to us, it's extraordinarily damaging. And we've all experienced it. And the key, though, is understanding how you are responding to it. And this is going to be super graphic. It's safe for work, but just a little bit of a warning. We call task overload or task saturation, the ultimate effect to that or end result to that can be, we call it dying relaxed. Because what happens is we become so fixated on something or we've shut down so completely. It's where, and again, a quick Google search, you can find this if you want to. You will fly people have flown perfectly good airplanes right into a target. Perfectly good airplanes. Because they become so task overloaded and so fixated on one thing, they've forgotten everything else they were supposed to do, as in fly the airplane, right? So task overload and task saturation, especially as entrepreneurs and as parents or as partners, task saturation is the number one killer to your good, successful execution and success. And there are basically two causes of it right now. The first is essentially information overload, right? It's the sheer mass and numbers of inputs that are assaulting our brains every day. We are simply not wired for this environment. And I don't want to sound old, like, oh, I had to walk uphill both schools and social media is terrible. Kids, get off your phones. That's not what I mean, right? That's not what I mean. But the sheer amount of information and the constant dings and bells and whistles and notifications is actually killing and shredding our ability to execute and to adapt. Our brains cannot sort and comprehend all this information, which is why it is very important to have your tracker, right? Because it takes the thinking part out of it. It puts you into a ritual, a routine, and a habit that frees your brain up to do the mental heavy lifting on everything else. And the second thing is that it's our inability when we become overloaded or saturated to correctly prioritize those inputs. Our brain becomes jelly. It no longer can correctly prioritize the most important things that need to be done. And what happens is our mind then starts to focus on a single thing in order to stabilize the situation, which is why in the last 3 months for so many people, huge, huge spike in Netflix and Hulu and time spent not necessarily posting on social media, but the actual physical scrolling. Like when they're starting to look at the data from the last 2 months, people are becoming less engaged in posting, but they're spending more time scrolling because your brain has stopped. It stopped trying to do anything else and it thinks it can manage scrolling, but actually what you're doing is you're adding more trash to your brain because now it's thinking about all the micro bits of information so that you're seeing visually. So it's information overload and then the inability to prioritize those inputs. So what can happen is that the reality is that when we're working, when we're trying to build our business, interruptions are going to occur. So we have to figure out and be able to quickly identify, how do I shut down? How am I dealing with task overload or task saturation? How are my teammates? How are the people I'm trying to serve? Are they, you know, the people, they're the people who, as soon as they become frazzled, they're like, that's it. I've had it. Boom, door slams, whatever, they walk out, they're done, right? They've tapped out, or they go super quiet because they've tapped out. They've tapped out. The other people become so single-handedly focused that they compartmentalize and they become very serial in nature. They're, they're vacuuming the floors. They're doing the laundry. They're doing all of these things really well in serial and in compartmentalizing, but not the thing that's actually the most valuable thing, right? Because it's getting that feeling of control back somehow, but it's not on the most valuable stuff. And the problem is your brain still in the back end is still thinking about knowing the things that actually does have to do. So we've got the I quit, you know, we've got it. Then we've got the channelized people, or the compartmentalized people, and then we've got the channelized people where they're so focused on that one task right in front of them that everything else disappears. So they're not getting anything else done except for the one thing. So what do we do with all of this? We have to recognize that it's going to happen, right? And when you have words, when you understand what's happening, then you can identify it and we prepare to prevent it. So we recognize it's going to happen. We know it's going to happen. We have training to identify it. And then we have to prepare to prevent it. How did we do it? And how did we plan to respond? In the aviation world, first flight ever, again, back to three things: aviate, navigate, communicate. They would tell you no matter what happens, aviate, fly the airplane. Number two, navigate. Get your nose pointed in a better direction. That's it, right? Just maybe it's right side up, right? But get it headed home or towards an airfield. Get it headed in an intentional direction. And the last thing is communicate. Tell people what you're doing. And too often we get this flipped around, even in business. We start just telling everybody, we're communicating all over, do this, do this, do this, when we're not even headed in the right direction, right? So when we're task overloaded, we want to recognize it's going to happen, right? So we may have to stop doing some of the things you used to be able to do, minimize those things, recognize it's going to happen. We want to prepare how we're going to respond to it. I suggest you keep your tracker open, right? Follow the framework. Know how you're going to respond and then debrief, like with yourself even. Did this work? Where did I get off task? How can I refocus to get back on task? What was the trigger, right? So you know better how to respond next time, because that ability to focus is going to, again, it's going to be your superpower. Your ability to focus on your well-defined vision will be the thing that differentiates you. It's not going to be if you show up more than everybody else on Instagram. It's not going to be if you just take one little piece of it and try to go hard on it. It's looking at everything and then focusing on those things that matter and being able to do that deep work, I'm going to call it, in really short periods of time, right? And understanding that you deserve to be here and that you showing up matters to the people right now who think they don't matter and that they don't make a difference. And you can be the catalyst to somebody by having those clear goals, by learning quickly, understanding there are going to be setbacks, and you show up anyway, right? Because how you show up matters to everybody. Somebody out there needs you showing up to give them the strength and the courage and the confidence so that they can show up. And it matters. It all matters.
I am obsessed with you, Carey Lohrenz. That's all I have to say about that. You're so freaking good. Aww. I took so many notes. And first, I mean, you know, my dad was in the Navy. So I'm like, this is like, I just love this language so much. But the whole idea of the aviate and the navigate and the communicate and the piece that I think where a lot of us get off track, and because I've been a coach for 12 years, so there's very little that anyone can say to me or experience, even within this pandemic, even within everything that's happening, this is not, nor will be, the only big life event that happens for us. Mm-hmm. And just because we're in it right now, maybe it feels that way, but we've all had big life events happen. We will have big life events happen again, whether it's individually or this, the thing that makes us different is this happening to everyone kind of at the same time, but we'll have something again that happens. And this idea of getting very clear. I mean, I could have you talk about clarity from now to the end of time, because I think that's such a huge piece of it. But there's such a gap between the knowing and the doing. And, you know, for 12 years, I've always heard, well, I know what I need to do. Or you see them get off track, myself included, and it takes a little bit to recalibrate and to course correct. And I feel like over 12 years, I hope to heck I've gotten a little bit better at it, or being able to get a little bit more quick at it, a little more agile. But there's the gap in, okay, the willingness to self-assess, number one. And then the knowing what you need to do, and then the doing. Like, can you speak to that a little bit at all to kind of wrap us up too?
Yeah. So that's a big execution gap, right? And I think the one thing that I think is critical for everybody, and again, this could easily be a 2-hour discussion. I want you to think about I'm not a therapist. I didn't stay at a Holiday Inn Express last night. Okay. But understanding what your mindset is and your limiting beliefs and what you believe to be is possible. And oftentimes these little gremlins are stuck back in our head from, you know, what somebody back in the day, our third grade teacher, I was in a gifted and talented math program when I was in school. And then I had a teacher who was an absolute freaking monster who ended up, my grandpa had died. I missed a bunch of school. I got my wisdom teeth out and I ended up flunking 2 quizzes. And so he put me in the very front row because that's where the stupid kids were put. And it shattered my self-confidence. And so in my mind, I've always been like, oh, I'm not really good at math. And I completely forgot about the first 9 years that I was, right? And because this person so terribly embarrassed me, I always kind of joke, oh, hey, I know math is hard. You know, even though I can do math at like twice the speed of sound really quick on an e-board, in my mind, I've been told I'm not good at math and people laughed at me, right? So, you know, there's that piece then that for me, even with my kids and with other people I coach, they're like, yeah, but what about this? And somebody says I'm this, or I just need more experience before I hop in. two things. There's one phrase I want you to write down. Well, there, good Lord, there are a bunch. But one I want you to write down and just remember is not yet. When you hit a wall, it doesn't mean you're not good at it. It doesn't mean you're not going to be valuable. It doesn't mean that you don't deserve to be there. It just means that particular time, that particular skill, you just don't have it yet. Somebody else may be able to hop in the bar program and like put their foot back over behind them and do squats for 17 minutes. And they're like, oh my gosh, I'm so sweaty and glowy. I love this program. And I'm like, y'all, I tipped over on my third squat. Like, I don't know how you're bending like that. And so I have to tell myself, not yet, right? Like, it may take me 27 times of going through this sequence or 27 times of, you know, I'm trying to meal plan, I'm trying to meal prep. And then God darn it, my husband brings home the plastic tub of chocolate covered almonds and raisins from Costco. And I'm three lids into it at 10:45 at night. And then I do the math and I'm like, that was 3,700 calories. We live to fight another day, right? So it's just the not yet. And telling people that you just don't have it just today, it's just not yet. But that doesn't mean we don't step up and we don't try again. And when we're going through all of this, the other thing I want to share with you is that adversity introduces you to yourself. We're all going to take a concrete block to the face. We all will. And if even in the last 3 months, you've been in a fortunate position where maybe you've stashed a lot of money away, or you have a spouse or a partner, or you're with your parents or whatever the case may be, you've got great roommates, and you're not feeling the same angst that some other people are, I promise you at some point in your life, you will take a concrete block to the face. Whether it's the loss of a loved one, a miscarriage, the death of a friend, a pet. And it's in those times that we have to figure out how are we going to move forward. So I'm going to prattle through a couple of things really, really quickly that I think are going to be, hopefully that will be helpful when we think about adversity and how we move forward, because even on this journey, you're going to have good times and bad times, right? As an entrepreneur and building your business and building your family and your teammates and all of this good stuff, is that the number one thing I want you to always remember is you have to reject victimhood. Right? If you get anchored in the, oh my gosh, why me? And why did this happen to me? And I'll share with you something I've only ever shared one time before. And it's not an experience that a lot of people haven't had. But for some of you on this call, it might be relatable. After my second child, I ended up having a miscarriage, and it was well into my second trimester. So yeah, pretty big pain. For me anyway, it was devastating. And I had to go through partial delivery and all that stuff. And the OB at the time said to me, brought me in, you know, whatever afterwards, and was like, hey, you know, I just want you to know this is going to be really hard. And everybody you see now, whether you go to the grocery store or whatever, is going to be pregnant. And all you're going to see are pregnant people or people with new babies. And I'm like, yeah, don't use this psychology on me. I know this. No, I'm going to be fine. And yet you get to the point, my husband was like, that's it. We're not having any more kids. We have two. We're not doing this again. You know, obviously it wasn't meant to be. Worst thing to say to somebody, right? And so then you can dip into this, why me? Why does this happen? And then people are like, you just need to be grateful for what you have. And you're like, I'm like profoundly sad. But we're all going to have to deal with loss at some point. And you can anchor in, it's always going to be this way. I'm always going to feel this sad. Like, it has a sense of permanence to it, of permanent sad or permanent loss. And if we stay anchored in that, and we all know people who have 3 years, 5 years, 7 years later, that now they're bitter and they're hard and they have an edge. And so adversity will introduce you to yourself. And the first step in developing resiliency as an entrepreneur and as a person is to just realize bad stuff is going to happen, right? So how do we get through this? How do we embrace this change and wrap our arms around it? And I would share with you, you know, this goes back to focusing on what matters. Look at the big picture again, right? What can you have affect control on? What is accepting? And then either find or be a wingman. When you are in the depths of despair, one of the fastest ways to get through it with your heart intact is to be a wingman to somebody else who's struggling. Put your hand out. I call it put the ladder down, right? It's easy to get up in an airplane. It's a lot harder to put the ladder back down to bring somebody with you. Put the ladder down. Bring somebody with you. Be a wingman. Find a wingman. Get this emotional support so that, you know, for some people and high performers and people on this team, and Julie, you've had such success for so long, asking for help can be very, very hard. Right? Because now you're gonna have to be vulnerable, maybe even to somebody who has stomped on you before. Maybe you have to find a wingman outside of your normal circle and within this team, right? Within this team. Because within this team that you've developed and that you're growing, we're all here for each other, and we need to leave space and grace for people to ask for help. And then just understand what you can control, right? Focus on those things that you can control. You can't control, you know, your goal every time you're showing up on social media, every time you're trying to share the value and the benefits of what a healthier, happier lifestyle or programs can be. You know, don't focus on that you need somebody to take action right now, that you need them. No matter what, no matter if people buy or not when they show up, you want them leaving inspired and inspired to take action. And if you continue to show up and show some vulnerability, and I don't think you need to share everything, right? There's a difference between being vulnerable and authentic and vomiting everything that's happening. There's a difference. But if you leave people inspired and excited to take action, eventually it will come back to you. And you don't know in what way, shape, or form, but it will come back to you. So just know that all of this stuff, in order to really continue to achieve success, you are going to have the strength and the courage to feel that fear and go forward anyway. And every time you do it in the littlest bits, it gives you more strength and more courage and more confidence to go a little bit bigger next time. Doesn't mean it's going to be perfect, right? Doesn't mean you're not going to have some setbacks, but you develop the sense within yourself of, I don't know, man, this is a complete shit show, but I'm going to figure it out. Right? And I call it, you know, I've had a couple of things even in business where, like, I had to pull the trigger on a day and completely change my business. This is about 2.5 years ago. And all my friends are like, oh my gosh, what are you going to do? And I'm like, I don't know, but I had to get out of this airplane and I am knitting my parachute like a fucker on the way down. And you do, right? And you have the confidence that you'll figure it out. But it's going back to these foundational elements, you know, Julian, you know, and you talk about all the time. It's the routine. It's the goals. It's the showing up when you don't feel like it. It's the showing up in spite of. It's the showing up because of. It's showing up because you matter, right? On days even where you feel like you don't matter, you matter. So show up, even if you're afraid. Even if you have a lump in your throat, you've got VERP coming up the back of your throat, you think you're going to crap your pants or pass out, show up anyway. Right? Probably a little different than some other people have told you, but you know what? So far, this stuff has worked for me. So.
Carey, you're just so amazing. It's just so clear and it's just so good and it's so real life that we just can't thank you enough. Can you tell them where they can find you and when your new book is coming out.
Yeah, so you can find me on all social. Again, I've been a little bit quieter on Instagram for the last couple of months. I'm gonna try to stepping back in there, but definitely on all the social channels, just under my name. My website is going through a bit of a rehab right now, but it's CareyLohrenz.com. My current book, Fearless Leadership, super easy read. Hopefully a little helpful. I wrote it myself, so no big words. And my new book is called Span of Control. And Julia, you probably saw like 2 weeks ago I put out, it was supposed to come out November 1st. And just this last week, we just pushed it to February 2nd.
Okay, that's rude. I'm so excited about it. I'm like on there signing up for the pre-order. I'm like, give it to me.
I know. So we, there, and there's a very specific reason for it. We have a really interesting dynamic happening right now in the political sphere.
Yeah.
And there are everybody who was supposed to be, even with the pandemic, launching books in April, May, June, have all pushed their books back. Mm. And if I launched my book at the beginning of November, as we planned, now all of a sudden you're right in the election cycle. It's right. All the political books and it's going to get lost. So the reason we're doing it February 2nd is because regardless of the side of the fence that you sit on politically, there's going to be half of the country that quite possibly is going to be a little bit upset and is going to be trying to figure out what they can do. And although we might release the ebook a little bit early, and quite frankly, with everything happening with COVID, all the printers have been, you know, nothing's coming from overseas, and we've already gotten rid of so much of our printing capabilities in the US. They're backlogged, so they didn't know if they were going to be able to handle the demand order that we were predicting, which is why we pushed it back to February 2nd. So, you know, it is what it is. Now, I could go, let's do it, but then it's either going to get drowned out and or it's going to be out of stock for 2 months. And I don't want that to happen because then people are like, what? Like, is it even real? So probably February 2nd now.
Will you read the audiobook?
Oh, heck yes.
Okay, good.
Absolutely.
Good. So her book, Fearless Leadership, is also on audio as well. So if you order it and you got to wait a couple of days, start it on audio as well. And because I listened to it as well as read it. And because I love doing both of those.
So. I do too. Yeah, I do all formats. I've got so many books and even in three formats because I tell myself I'll read it on my Kindle, but I don't recall anything when I read my iPad.
Yeah.
I think I do and I don't. But I audible at like 1.5 on an iPhone. Mm-hmm. Perfect.
The game changer. Audio is a game changer. It really is.
100%. Julie, yeah. I know we're bumping up on time here. Do you have, or does anybody else here who you've been so patient, have any other questions? I feel like I talked a lot and didn't answer a lot of questions.
You had so much information. We were just like soaking it all in. And I love Amber's comment because Amber's got a husband who's deployed right now on one of those aircraft carriers. Mm-hmm. So nice for her to feel connected to that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I think we were all just writing so fast that it was so good. And it was exactly, you know, it was exactly what we needed. It's that, again, that confirmation, that reminder that it's just so much about clarity. And I know we kind of chatted one time on Instagram a little bit about the new Bob Iger book, which I was obsessed with, still am. I recommend it to every single person ever. And when he took over as CEO, you know, he went through this process of boiling down the three keys, the pillars, he called them, that he wanted to do for the entire Disney organization. And they remained as pillars the entire time, not 33, and everything fell underneath that. And when I read that, I thought, well, my goodness, if you can build a multi-billion dollar company focusing on three pillars, surely we can run challenge groups and build a business that changes lives doing that same thing. You know, why we overcomplicate, it's a female thing. We overcomplicate it. We overthink it and overcomplicate it. It's a female issue.
100%. And so two things. Now it feels a little tired, but I go back to even Apple. When we think about Apple, if you think about walking into an Apple store, how clean everything is. Mm-hmm. They've got iPhones, iPads, and iMacs. That's it. Mm-hmm. They're not doing, it's not like going into Best Buy where it's a smorgasbord of everything, right? Because they also know that with the paradox of choice, that if you have too many things, you're going to end up walking out, not buying anything because it's too overwhelming.
Right.
And getting back to what you were just saying too, Julie, one of the challenges and opportunities that everybody has, even in this business right now, when it comes to women and certainly in the corporate, not just the sales or the like kind of MLM world a little bit, but from a personality trait, it's still true. Women work so hard to de-risk everything because we all feel like we have this microscope on us, and that especially when we're trying to do something more expansive or something daring or something that our circle hasn't done before, we work so hard to de-risk it. We want it to be perfect. If there's a checklist that says we need to have these 10 things, we might have 9 3/4 things and go, oh, I can't launch it because I don't have that yet. Where the guys, they'll go 1, 2, they fill their name and they're like, boom, I'm launching it. Cause who wouldn't want to hear from me? Right? Next thing you know, you're following them on social and you're like, what? People are signing up for their stuff. They don't care. They're dropping stuff. They're messing up. They're whatever. But so it's understanding that as long as we, and hey, I'm rolling a bowling ball in my own glass house on this, hands down. I am a work in progress on this because I am visible in what I do, that I feel like I have to be very careful what I put on social media because I have so many people who are lurking even on LinkedIn and everywhere else that I don't feel like I have the same latitude that the guys who are in my industry are doing the same thing can throw turd balls out there and people are like, look at Jeff. Silly man, right? But so women, because we're still one of few or in our mind mentally, we put maybe we look at who the top 5, top 10, top 20 coaches are and we're like, but I'm not that. So why do I think I should be able to show up until I'm like that? But that's where, again, I'd flip the script and go, yeah, not yet. You may not have all of that, just not yet. But do not let that stop you from showing up because it's in the showing up part that gets you closer to that. There's no easy button. There's no hack on that. But you all do have a proven framework for success. Go with that. Don't reinvent the wheel. We don't need to be Wilma Flintstone trying to figure out if there's a rounder wheel out there. It's crazy. Right? It's why we in Naval Aviation, you go, if you went and sat in primary flight school right now, the new aviators, their checklists and the routine and how they prepare will be identical to what I did 20 years ago. The airplane's just different. Because that's what works. And you can't skip those steps. If you try to skip those, You might be successful for a period of time and then you'll delude yourself into thinking, oh, see, I didn't have to do what Julie said. I'm going to be okay. Yeah, you might be for a month, but if you're trying to expand and grow, it's not scalable. It's not going to make the impact for as long. So use the tools that you have available. Julie, you're such a great resource. Like, you guys have a great team. Now you just have to have the courage to execute. And the discipline to do it.
Mm-hmm. So true. I mean, I started this business
Not easy.
Not easy. Yeah. I started this business on MySpace. I'm still inviting. I'm just now inviting on Instagram. It's the same concept. I've just changed the platform. So the plane is different, but I'm still doing the same, you know, it's the same tracker.
Yeah.
So I know there's going to come a time I'm going to say MySpace and people are not going to even know what that is. So,
well, hopefully there'll be a couple of us on.
We're still around.
I love you here. Take my money.
Okay. I'm going to take a picture really quick. I'll do a video so that I can expand it, and it's just been so great.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh my gosh, y'all, like, this has just been a treat. Okay, I'm going full screen so I can video. Okay, here we go. Everyone smile, look cute. See, I don't ever take a picture without giving warning because I think that's just incredibly rude. So here's your warning. Smile, look cute. It is a video though, so you can like do things, you can, you know, wave, you can hold up books, you, yeah, wave, hold up your notes, do all the things. Look at this. So great. So great. Okay. Awesome. Awesome. Thank you, Carey. Thank you so much. And Karen, I wanted to tell you, like, Karen, you're right next to Carey on my Zoom. Carey lives in Minnesota. Karen lives in Minnesota. So you guys can connect on Instagram afterwards and talk about Minnesota things. I don't know what those would be, but you can chat about that being in Minnesota. So we are just so appreciative of your time this morning on a Saturday morning. I just can't even tell you, you were exactly what, for selfish reasons, what I needed this morning. I hope, you know, what other people needed this morning, the idea of clarity and focus. It's just, it's so great. And we can't wait till your new book comes out later rather than sooner. But in the meantime, we shall all go back and reread and re-listen to the current one.
Yeah. And hey, from a feedback perspective and debriefing, even if anybody, and I think Instagram's probably super easy. If you have a question, a comment, or you have a question about, you need something clarified. If you were like, yeah, I wasn't really sure what you were saying on then, call me out on it, right? Because I'm so deep in the weeds on this and I'm so excited about the opportunity that you guys all have right now. The opportunity for you and this team to make an impact has never been better than right now. It's never been better. People need what it is you have to offer, and all the onus is again on you to have the courage to execute, however imperfect some days it may be, but just continue to show up and know there's a long tail. Know that there's a long tail. Just keep showing up and inspiring people, and all good things will come back.
So great. Perfect way to end. Thank you so much. Everyone go follow Carey Tagger on social, and let's have an amazing Saturday.
Yes. Thanks, everybody.